Welcome to Campus, the magazine all about university sports. And in this first program of the year, we look at some of the stories that made up the recent Winter Universiade in Trentino, meeting some of the outstanding competitors among the thousands who dedicated themselves to months of training in order to discover just what they were capable of. We'll start with some of the campus team. Those are the athletes we chose to follow over the weeks leading up to the games, like the Canadian snowboarder Audrey McManaman and the men's curling team from Sweden. She's only 18. She won the gold in slopestyle at the Youth Olympic Games at Innsbruck in 2012. A student at Quebec City. And here at the Universiade, she competed in two disciplines, slopestyle and the halfpipe. I just arrived. I've been waiting for this moment, you know. I'm so excited. I trained for it for a long, long time. We've seen the halfpipe track. It's really nice. Good construction as well. And, you know, I'm ready to go. And so into the halfpipe with her friends Anfred and Tamara, also in the Canadian snowboard team, giving her plenty of support. But in the semi-finals, on the second run, she would fall. Audrey, a bit disappointed. She'd hoped to make that final round. I missed my landing, but I guess in the end, the halfpipe is only my second discipline. I just try the halfpipe for pleasure, really. I'm sure in slopestyle, things will be better. And a few days later, the last day of the Universiade, this was Audrey's second run in the final in slopestyle. If she lands correctly on this second run, she could be the winner. But unfortunately, Audrey made an early mistake, and now she'd have to take risks to have any chance of a place on the podium. If she's doing tricks like this, it means she fell down on the first jump. I don't think she's happy. No podium for Audrey. She finishes fourth. Unfortunately, I fell in both final rounds. You know, I should have been able to do that run easily. I made unforgivable mistakes, I really did. But the season is just beginning, and I will go on. For sure, I'm disappointed. I missed the podium. But you know, that's sport, isn't it? And you simply need to carry on. Barcelgo de Pinay, the headquarters for the Swedish curling team, Oscar Eriksson and his mates.
It's a big honor representing Sweden, for sure. This is the first time with this team, so it's new for all of us together. Let's go to the hotel and meet the rest of the team. Let's go.
Where we found the guys really relaxed, playing cards. Didn't they have exams to work for?
We don't want to study when we are in a tournament. He has to study more, so maybe he needs to study, but I don't have to study.
I have to study quite a lot now when I'm here, but I'm focused on the curling when I have to, and the studies. Yeah, well, later on the nights and stuff like that. So.
We were in Canada for 5 weeks and played 5 tournaments against the best teams in the world. And we did pretty good in 3 tournaments and tried our best in the other 2.
And the boys are not alone. 2 mums have come over from Sweden to support their boys. In the group stage, Sweden, right up there at the top. They lost just 1 match, that against the Canadians. But then the semi-finals against Norway, they didn't start too well. But finally, Norway buckled and Sweden won 6-3 in 10 ends of play.
They played a much better game than they did in the group. So it was really tight. They managed to steal 1 in the 5th end to go up to 2-1. After that, we said we just have to keep playing really good and hope to get a big break. And we did it already in the 6th end. So since that, we just controlled the game. Today is the big day, the final. I feel relaxed and really comfortable. This is what we've been waiting for all week. Play the final.
So once more onto the ice, the final against Great Britain. The Swedish boys really focused. They had a few fans there as well, willing them to victory. And they won the gold medal for Sweden and the campus team.
Playoffs were tough. We played good. All Norway and Great Britain played good as well, but we were the better team.
In 4 years, Olympics, we will see you there.
See you in South Korea.
In part 2 of Campus, we meet Mirko Nancy, Teresa Hoyset, Norway's speed skating coach, Luke Piggott, a British doctor on the ice, and the awesome Canadians too. He's Italian, born in Venice, 24 years of age, and the ice rink is his passion. We took the road to meet him at the Pine rink. Mirko Nancy is a student of psychology and a member of the Italian fiscal police team. He joined that small band of athletes who managed to win medals of all 3 colors.
In questa università sicuramente noi atleti italiani avevamo una grande Italian athletes, we had a lot of pressure because it was at home.
On the other hand, though, we were also the favorites because we competed on tracks where we train every day, so it really wasn't that difficult to obtain the result we had overall, I think.
Questa medaglia d'oro,
this gold medal, I won it in the 1,000 meters. I set a new track record and a new Universiade record too, breaking the previous one set by Enrico Fabris. And this gold medal for sure is the most special.
Poi, then, c'è una d'argento, che è la prima,
it's the first I've won in the Universiades and the 500 meters. I was beaten by the Japanese athlete,
Hasegawa.
Bit of a surprise to be second, though. I had a great race, I really wasn't expecting to be second.
2005.
The other silver medal is from the 1500 meters. I was beaten by Jan Szymanski, a great specialist over that distance. But I gave it my best, and I wasn't expecting that one either.
E l'ultima di bronzo.
And the last one, the bronze medal. I think really this is the most important because he won it as 4 athletes. Me, Dal Dossi, Giovannini, Andrea Stefani in the team pursuit. So this medal has a huge significance for the entire nation and for the sport of skating in Italy particularly.
Io sarò a Sochi.
I'm going to be in Sochi, so we've already started the preparations. We've started the winter training.
And there are the World Championships in Nagano that will involve us from the middle of January to the end of January.
And then we'll arrive in Sochi, of course, and that is the goal of a lifetime.
Sochi, che è l'obiettivo finale di una vita, ecco.
We stay with speed skating to meet a former Olympic athlete. Today she's the coach of the Norwegian skaters and a key figure in Trentino, Teresa Hoiseth.
I'm the only woman who coaches in Norway now, I think, at a higher level. I am, yeah.
Teresa meets other coaches, familiar faces, who nowadays are work colleagues as well.
I think they mostly respect me. Some of them I've known for a very long time because they've been skating too, some of them, and I've seen them before, so I think they respect me.
Teresa's signature on the track is this.
Maybe somebody think I scream too much, but I scream to make them feel that I care for them, that I really want them to skate good, and also to motivate them to do their best and to get out the power they have. So yeah, that's why I scream and I get enthusiastic. So it's in me, it's natural.
Whichever way you look at it, she certainly has close contact with her athletes.
With some of them, I have a very good and close relation. Some of them I follow what they do every day on training, and some of them I don't know that good, but because they are qualified for this team, but some of them I really follow and try to make them improve every day to be a faster and better skater.
Det hjalp meg med å forbedre teknikken mens jeg var der, så det kunne gå litt fortere. Jeg tror det er en ganske lang vei dit ennå, men...
My back mind is to build them up to be as good as they can be. I don't want to do it too fast, because then you need to go the steps, step by step, to be better. And yeah, I think I don't want to do it too fast, because then they jump over a step, and maybe sometimes you need to go back and then take the next step. So build them slowly up to be as best as they can.
Teresa is not sweet. She's really hard. But I think you have to be hard if you want to get results. And yeah, that's the way she likes to do it, and we like it too.
And I care for them, that not only as a skater, but I want to that they are emotionally happy with themselves, and try to encourage them to stand up for who they are.
Bye, Teresa.
We stay on the ice in Canazé with the captain of the Great Britain ice hockey team. He's competing in his third University Winter Games, having previously represented Great Britain in Turin in 2007 and China in 2009. The Universiade in Trentino was the last for him.
Luke Piggott, I'm 27 years old. I'm the captain of the Great Britain University ice hockey team. So I started my studies at Cardiff University doing an undergraduate degree in medical biochemistry. I went on to do my master's following that, and then I continued into doing a PhD, which in breast cancer research. My typical day is I'll go to the ice rink in the morning, and we practice four times a week. So we're on the ice early in the morning, relatively early, at 10 o'clock in the morning, and we practice for about an hour and 45. So I quite often don't get to the lab to do some research until about midday. But that just means that I have to stay a little bit later into the evening to make sure I get all my research done. It's not been too tough to mix. I mean, at times, obviously, the amount of time spent in the lab is a little bit of a strain. I've become a lot more organized over the years as a result of having to mix the two of them, and I think that'll really help me later in life as well. We practice four times a week. so that obviously puts a strain on my studying a little bit, but I was lucky in the sense that my supervisor and my coach, both very understanding people, so you know, both of them were happy for me to do both careers so long as I was getting the work done both on the ice and both off the ice. Yeah, so I had a recent discovery, which was a novel therapy for breast cancer, and the work in the laboratory, we do a lot of work on what are called breast cancer stem cells. And what that means is cancer stem cells make up a really small proportion of the tumor cells, which are within the lump that you would typically find. And it's this small population of cells which is really responsible for the spread of the cancer to secondary sites, which is ultimately what would be for the fatality of the patient. So our work focuses primarily on this small subset of cells. I think one of the things which is common between the ice hockey and the research is teamwork. I obviously work with a team on the ice. It's a team orientated sport, obviously. And what a lot of people don't realize is actually research in the laboratory is a team effort as well. We have more than one person frequently working on the same sort of project, and we're all working together in the research environment to try and come up with these novel therapies. So I think that's one thing which is consistent across both of the two things. This is my third, obviously, time being to the Universiade, and it's always a great experience. You learn a lot of things, and we're playing against players at the top levels of the game. You can see from the game when we played against the Russians how good they were, how quickly they moved the puck, and I think you learn a lot just by playing against that caliber of player. The huge thing is just the experience of the whole Universiade and the environment, and you know, being a part of something so big and such a great experience, I think.
Well, after Great Britain, let's take a look at the whiz kids of ice hockey, the Canadians. For the Canadian women, gold for the Canadian men as well after a 6-2 win against Kazakhstan. So much joy, the ice almost melted.
Hockey's a big big part of our country and our culture, and anytime we can represent our country and win a gold medal in hockey, it's exciting.
The Canadian girls have taken the gold in the last three university games. We won the tournament, it's pretty fantastic, we're so happy.
Represent our country and put the jersey on feels great, and to have both gold medals feels awesome.
The experience has been amazing. Getting to know the team and representing the country has been an amazing feeling.
It's all about the social experience too, you know, and that's one of the things that this event really thrives with, is that social experience.
Just really excited about what we did here and just kind of how everything came together and worked out.
Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for
outstanding talent in Trentino from the Winter University Games as campus continues. For one great Polish biathlete, the Trentino Universiade was her last. she was one of only four athletes who go back home with four medals. Winner of the sprint and the pursuit, and silver medalist in the individual and the mass start.
My name is Veronika Nowakowska-Ziemniak. I'm 27 biathlete and a student at the Academy of Physical Education in Katowice, in Poland, of course. I'm very happy that I have opportunity to represent my university, because they're helping me a lot, especially from last 4 years. I can use the professors and they help me also somehow preparing my training plan. So I think without my university, I could not be so good athlete as I am now. So I can say only thank you very much. I feel very excited. It's totally different than World Cups. I'm more relaxed here. I have a feeling that the other athletes from Poland are like my family now. They're supporting me and the rest of the team, so it's really, really nice. And yeah, of course, also results are good, so I can stay in good mood. Soon we will have Olympic Games, and this is the university. It's like a last test before the Olympic Games, so I'm really excited and I'm trying to stay focused. It's a good atmosphere, everything, but somehow I'm trying to enjoy, but also to stay focused like I have to be during the Olympic Games. I think I'm a very vulnerable person, and I have to tell you that it's not always good when you're an athlete, because sometimes you have to be like a stone, don't feel anything, no emotions, just you do your job. And usually I have a problem with that. I feel too much. And even if somebody will tell me something not nice, I don't feel well, you know? He can change my mood just like that. And I have to work on myself to have a border around me. I'm a person who cannot to be on the one place. I always trying to find the new aims in my life, in sport and also in studying. So as I said, when I finish this, I will try to do something else.
Veronica's father passed away last year. She dedicated her four medals to his memory. Women's ski jumping was included in the University Games program as a demonstration discipline at Innsbruck in 2005. In Trentino, a young Slovenian, a student in criminology, won two medals, gold in the individual and bronze in the mixed team event.
I'm very, very happy because I didn't expect it to be that good, because my jumping was really bad in the past months. So these were the two best jumps I made, and it's still improving.
Katja Pozon is at Maribor University and has benefited from a special sporting program.
I'm jumping in the winter and then study from March to July. They are very flexible, they help me a lot. They allow me to choose when I want to ride something. So they are really, really nice to me.
What is going to happen now?
I can't see much in the future.
Same point about ski jumping and criminology is courage and self-esteem. So I'm glad to be in the both parts of this. Yeah, it's nice to be here, to be that part of this FISU and ski jumping with the girls. I ended my career 4 years ago and 5 years ago, and then I came back to fight for women to jump on the Olympics and World Cup, and everything started at this time. It's still a new discipline, but the girls jump a lot of time and they were fighting to be on this level that the boys we are getting here.
And the work's paying off. Women's ski jumping will take place at the Sochi Olympics. Good luck to Katja. For the third Universiade in a row, it was the Russian team that won the most medals. Right across the Russian Federation, sport is seen as a priority. At the 26th Winter Universiade in Trentino, altogether 234 medals were awarded, split between 32 nations. But the largest collection, as we said, went to Russia. 15 gold, 16 silver, 19 bronze. With a total of 50 athletes stepping up onto the podium.
Russia has a very strong tradition in university sports, in sport, and we are trying to do our best to bring the best athletes, best students, to give them chance to realize themselves through Universiade.
Russian athletes are traditionally strong in winter endurance sports, but they've begun to shine in disciplines right across the board.
Here in Trentino, we see that we got the medals not just one discipline, like cross-country ski or biathlon. I can say in all disciplines, speed skating, alpine skiing. So it's good because it demonstrates our position that we are ready to develop all sport.
I think we are really high motivated in this season because of Olympics, of course. And I think our level is growing up now, and they were training so hard in this summer, and we a little bit change the strategy to how to prepare to the season, and now we get the result.
We found Russians in the men's final in slopestyle too.
All our sportsmen will walk for Olympic Games, are walking for Olympic Games now, and Russians all the time walk on 100%.
With the last Summer Games held in Kazan and the Olympics taking place in Sochi, the Russians have certainly had plenty of motivation to go higher, faster, and stronger. Trentino closing ceremony came the traditional exchange of garments and memorabilia, a symbol of the camaraderie and friendship of the games. So a Latvian might take on a Swedish look, a Chinese, a Japanese look. Who's the volunteer and who wasn't? And this fella might be Russian, but wait a minute, Japanese. This girl, well, she looked Canadian. But was she? And he's probably in the Russian team, or maybe not. With two Universiades taking place, the year 2013 was a very rich one for FISU. The International Federation of University Sports produced the platform for thousands of students to express themselves at the games and live the experience to the full. We'll recall some of the most powerful emotions in the next edition of Campus on February the 19th. Until then.